forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your
Good morning, everyone. Now let us prepare our heart for the Holy Communion service. Now, just in case you have not prepared the cup and the bread, please pause the video and then get the cup and the bread, then continue. I'm going to read to you a scripture found in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28 to verse 31. It says here, "But let the man examine himself, and so let him eat the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak, sick, and many sleep," means many died. Verse 31, "For if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged." Now, before we take this cup and this bread, I want to encourage all of you to examine yourself first. Because if you don't discern the Lord's body and you take this cup and this bread in an unworthy manner, the Bible says you're going to eat damnation, judgment to yourself. Now, what does that mean by eating the bread and the cup in an unworthy manner? Now, the context here is talking about the Corinthian church. Because in the church, in the Corinthian church, there were a lot of infightings. There was a lot of disunity. There was backbiting. There was slandering. They were angry with each other. They were having envy and jealousy. Now, this is talking about taking Holy Communion service. So when we take this Holy Communion service and then we don't prepare our heart, we are actually taking it in an unworthy way. So then the result will be what? If you look at verse 30, many will fall sick, many become weak physically, and eventually die. So I want to encourage you with this one word, examine yourself. So let's pray for this bread and this cup so that we will not drink judgment to our own self. And let's confess our sins before Him. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for your living word. We thank you for this cup and this bread. Thank you for what Jesus has done for all of us at the cross of Calvary. Thank you for His shed blood. Thank you for His broken body. Today, because of the body of Christ, the blood of Jesus, we have been redeemed and we have been adopted as sons and as children of God. Today, as we take this cup and this bread, help each one of us to remember that the church is a body. The church is a unit. Therefore, we must exercise restraint. We must exercise love and unity in our midst. May you bring this church together. We already experienced the unity, but we pray that you will foster this unity, that you will continue to bring each one of us to be knitted together, to be joined together, so that we can be one of one heart, one mind for your glory. Today we pray you bless this cup and this bread. We pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. The Lord Jesus, the night when he was betrayed, he took the bread and said, "This is my body. Take this in remembrance of me. Let's take the bread together. In the same way, the Lord Jesus said, this cup represents the New Testament of my blood. Let's drink this cup together in remembrance of him. Amen. At this time, let's prepare ourselves to give to the Lord our tithes and offering. I'm going to read to you the book of Malachi, chapter 1, verse 6. It says here, a son honors his father, a servant his master. if then I am the Father, God is saying, where is my honor? And if I am a master, where is my reverence? Say the Lord of hosts. Now, reading this portion of scripture, you can see very clearly God was doing a comparison between himself and our fathers, earthly fathers, and also our bosses. God is saying, mankind, men today, they give honor to their boss, they give honor to their father, but when come to God, they don't give the kind of honor that is due to him, they don't give him that kind of reverence. Now, what do you mean by honoring your father? What do you mean by honoring your dad and honoring your boss or bosses? You see, whenever come to their birthday, how do you give to them? You will sure find the best present that you can find in town and then give it to them. And you also will give them an offering. And how much would that offering be? It won't be one ringgit. It won't be 5 ringgit. Because 5 ringgit is just equivalent to what? To a bowl of Hokkien Mee or a bowl of noodles. I want to challenge you today that God need to be reverent. God need to be honored. Now, if your giving year after year has been the same, always 1 ringgit or maybe 50 cents, can I encourage you, change. Change your giving. Change the amount on what you're going to give. Learn to give in such a way that you honor him, that you reverence the Lord. The amount, I leave it to you, between God and you. This is the message for the collection of offering. Let's prepare our heart. Let's pray at this moment for the tithes and offering. Praise God. Father, we thank you that you are the God of the universe. You own everything. You have given us all things. And you have blessed us, each one of us, with all spiritual blessing, not only in heaven, but also material blessing that we can find on this earth. Thank you for being our provider. Year after year, month after month, and day after day. You have not failed. Even in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, you have proven yourself faithful and good. May I pray for our church people today. And as we part our finance, as we give our finance, help us to give in such a way that we will reverence you and honor you. Bless this offering as we give to you. Bless our thanks as well. We give thanks. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
seen things above of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when I sing the new song, 'twill be the old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell Jesus and His love, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love.
Amen. Once again, on behalf of the church, I want to say a big thank you to all of you for watching online, right in your own home, maybe from the kitchen, maybe inside your living hall, or right inside your big room. But whatever it is, I want to say a big thank you to you. May God's grace, God's mercy, God's favor be upon you and your family. Today, we are still continuing our study on the book of Acts. Today, my text is found in Acts chapter 8, verse 35. It says here, "Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning at that scripture," what did he do? He preached. Who did he preach? The Bible says he preached Jesus to him. Now, keep your hand right here in Acts chapter 8. And let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, this morning, we thank you for your word again. Once again, I avail myself to you as a vessel that you can use for your glory. Anoint me with your spirit. Enable me with your Holy Spirit. I submit myself to you. I allow the Holy Spirit to lead and to guide me as I explain the scripture and as I teach the scripture. We give thanks, we pray in Jesus' wonderful and glorious name. All God's people say, amen and amen. Today, my title is on what? The importance of one soul. The importance of one soul. Now, what we have learned last week, we learned that there was a great persecution that came upon the city of Jerusalem. And as a result of that persecution, all, the Bible says, all were scattered. Look at chapter 8, verse 1. Every single one of them, the Bible says, all were scattered all over the place. and they went to Judea and Samaria. What did they do? Look at Acts 8 verse 4. They went everywhere preaching the gospel. Can you see sometimes God used suffering, difficulties to force his people to do his will? And one of those many that went out from Jerusalem was a man named Philip, a layman, a man who served table. And guess what? God was about to change his man, his ministry, and what God was about to change him to become an evangelist. Today, let us look at the first point concerning Philip. Philip and the mission. Philip and the mission. All along, you find Philip was preaching in the city of Samaria, and he was preaching the gospel to crowds, to multitude. Now God was about to change his mandate, change his mission. Instead of preaching to multitudes, now God wants to use him to preach only to one soul. And that soul was none other than the Ethiopian eunuch. Now you may ask me, why we come to Acts chapter 8? Why God put this chapter right here? Now if you study the book of Acts, right from the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2 onwards, Acts chapter 3, talking about the layman at the gate beautiful, then Acts chapter 7, Stephen, every single event, you find the apostle, they were preaching to multitudes. They were preaching to crowds. But when you come to Acts chapter 8, you see a great example of personal evangelism. It is on one evangelism. Do you know this is a very, very important ministry in the church? Yes, thank God for Alpha 3.0. That is a group effort. But yet at the same time, I want to encourage the church not to neglect personal evangelism, one-on-one evangelism. During these few weeks of Alpha 3.0, the trust itself, the service, etc., etc., I want to encourage you, if God were to open a big door for you to share your faith to somebody, please do so. And that's my message, the importance of one soul. Look at the life of Jesus. What do you see? He always practiced personal evangelism. He preached to crowds, multitudes. At the same time, he zeroed down to preach to one soul. Just to name a few, he preached to the woman at the well, you remember? He preached to who? Nicodemus. He also preached to Zacchaeus. Even right on the cross, at a time when he was about to leave this earth, he was still witnessing. Can I encourage you? Don't ever neglect this ministry. This is a very, very important ministry in the church, but it's the most neglected ministry in the church. Don't forget to witness to one soul. Let's look at the first point. Let's look at how God communicated that order for Philip. Now look at your Bible. Look at verse 26 of Acts chapter 8. The angel of the Lord was sent by God, and the angel spoke to Philip, saying, "Arise and go towards the south. Go down from Jerusalem together. You may be wondering how far was that? It was about 92 kilometers. God was telling this man, and this man was in the midst of a great revival. You can read all that from Acts chapter 8, verse 5, right down to verse 8. And then, in the midst of the great, great revival, lame people were healed, paralyzed people were healed, demons were cast out, many were healed by the power of God, and many were saved. In the midst of all that revival, God sent a message through his angel to this man, a layman, a man who served table. And God told him, get up, go down from Jerusalem. Don't stay in Jerusalem. Go down all the way to Gaza. Go down there. And that was about 92 kilometers away. Why God sent him there? Bible was actually silence. Bible didn't say it there and then. You see, sometimes God's leading in our life is like that. Sometimes he keeps us in the dark. He only gave one order. He only gave one instruction. And he expects you to follow. And after you follow, you will see some light. You will have some understanding. Then you will have some clue. And this is how God leads each one of our life, and also how he led Philip. Look at this verse. Psalms 77 verse 19. Psalmist David say, your way, talking about Yahweh and his ways. He says, your way was in the sea, your path in the great waters, and your footsteps were not known. Now look at all the description here. The way of God, the path of God, the footstep of God. Verse 19 says, nobody knows. Why? Because it says his way is in the sea. Then he says, my path is in the great waters. When you look at the sea, you can't see what is happening down or beneath the sea. Am I right? What happened underneath the seabed, nobody can tell. Nobody can know. And this is how God leads our life. This is where we have to practice faith and trust in the Lord, our God. And that is what we see in our first point, the order for Philip. Then number two, let us look at the outlook for Philip. The outlook, where exactly God told him to go. You look at verse 26, right at the very last sentence of that verse. Three words. The Holy Spirit mentioned, this is desert. This is what? Desert. That was Philip's outlook. When he went down to Gaza, where was he supposed to go? He's supposed to go to the desert. Now, who actually goes to the desert? Nobody wants to go to the desert. Am I right? But yet, God sent this evangelist. God sent this layman. God sent this man who served table. God asked him to go to which place? God asked him to go to the desert. And that was God's way for Philip. Let's look at number three. The obedience of Philip. Look at verse 27, the first part. After hearing the orders of God, knowing that it was a desert, the Bible says, verse 27, he arose and went. He arose and went. Such an obedient layman of God. Don't you agree? How many of us are like that? When God gives a command, we respond straight away. Now look at this man. No argument was even stated. No dilly-dally business. No hesitation. No delay. No question asked. He just arose and went. I want you to see here the greatness of this man. He trusted God in all that he said. Now that was my first point. Philip and the mission. Now let's look at number two. Philip and the man. Philip and the man. Now as he begins to obey God and went down from Jerusalem, went all the way down to Gaza. The moment he reached the desert, what did he discover? What did he see? You look at verse 27. He arose and went. Verse 27 says, and behold, New KJV says, and behold, a man was right there. Let me tell you, every time when God leads you, God won't tell you everything. He sometimes keeps you in the dark. But as you begin to follow, God will throw some light. God will throw some understanding to you. Then eventually, you'll be able to see the things clearly. And that was what we see here. Philip, as he went, and true enough, he saw somebody was there. Now, this is very strange. We are talking about a desert place. Nobody will be there. But yet, God knew way ahead of time. The Bible says, behold, a man of Ethiopia. He was from Africa. So this man was an African. Now, what kind of a man was this man? Number one, we see that this man was a religious man. How do we know that he was a religious man? Number one, because we see concerning his worship. Look at verse 27. He went to Jerusalem, verse 27 say, he went there only for one purpose. He went there to worship the true God. But of course, we know he worshiped God in the wrong way. He embraced Judaism as a religion. He embraced this true God. But he didn't go through the right channel, the right way. The right way. Just like today, there are many staunch religionists, we call them religionists. Very staunch people. Staunch in their belief. Staunch in their what? In their religion. They won't budge. They won't give in. That goes the same with your friends. Your loved one. Just last February, because of the Alpha 3.0, I tried to invite an Hindu friend. A Hindu friend. Alright, to the cause. I asked him to come. You know what he said? His reply was, I had my own religion. Every now and then, I will go to the temple. Can you see? He was staunch in his belief. He was faithful to his God. But he was faithful in a wrong way. And the same goes when I invited my two loved ones to the Alpha course. Their reply was, Let's see. But not now. Later. You see, today's people are like that. Today's people's heart is hardened. Like this eunuch. He had a religion. He came to Jerusalem for the purpose of worship. But he worshipped the wrong God. Now look at secondly. How do we know that he was a religious man? Not only through his worship, but also through his way. You know how far was Ethiopia? Right up to Jerusalem. You look at the map. How far was that? If you want to know how far, you can check the Google. It is about 2,500 kilometers away. So this man came all the way, such a long, long distance. He went to Jerusalem for the purpose of worship. But notice carefully, This man was religious, but he was not saved. Let me tell you today, many people who had their religion, they are very pious in their belief towards their faith. Some even made pilgrimages, some even yearly, to the Holy Lands, some to Rome, some to Jerusalem, and some to other parts of the world. But let me tell you, these people are lost. They don't know what they worship. They have religion, but they are not saved. They are just like this Ethiopian eunuch. Look at this verse in John chapter 10, verse 1. This is a very powerful verse. It says what? Jesus said, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold," look at the three words, "by the door." The three words, "by the door." You don't enter the sheepfold by the door, but you climbs up. Look at the word, climbs up, some other way. The word climbs up. You know, when you climb a wall, when you climb a tree, it takes some energy. It takes some effort. That's what most of the religion in this world are. Am I right? They are putting a lot of effort into their faith, trying to please so-called the God of heaven. Today, let me tell you the good news. You no need to try to climb up the wall. You can use the door. The door has been provided for you. That's what the Bible says. Either you enter through that door, or you try to climb your way up to heaven. And I tell you, a lot of people, when they reach heaven's shore, when they come to their judgment, they'll be greatly disappointed. Because they realize, after all those years of commitment and faithfulness to their religion, they finally found out that it was a false religion. Look at the Bible says, those who climb up some other ways, the same is a what? It's a thief. It's a what? Robbers. How many of you welcome thieves and robbers to your home? You won't, right? That goes the same with heavens. All those who try to climb up to heaven using works, using religion, they'll be greatly disappointed on that day. God will call them what? Thieves and robbers. And they'll be cast out from heaven. And that is what this verse is trying to tell us. Thank God for all of you who have gone through that door, entered by the door. Today you are saved. Now, not only that, let's look at John chapter 10. Verse 9. This is also another powerful verse. Jesus said what? "I am that door. If anyone enters by me," only through me, only by me, not through any other religion or founder of any religion, not even man, not even dead man. The Bible says, if you enter by me, what he says, he will be saved. Make sure, if you are born in the Christian family, having parents who are Christians, and you have been coming to church since small until now, let me tell you, sometimes you are not even saved. Yes, make sure you personally open up your heart and make sure you enter through that door. Make sure you ask Jesus to come to your life, to forgive your sins. If not, you are also embracing Christianity just like a religion. But inside your heart, there's no change. There's no transformation. Then he says what? Those who enter by me, he will be saved. And he will go in and out and find pasture. What does that mean? It means you have life. You see, sheep need pasture. They need what? Grass to eat. When you eat, you live. not only physical life, God is saying, you will have spiritual life. You will go in and out and find pasture. So here, you find that this eunuch was a religious man. Because of one, his worship, his way. Number three, he also read the word. Look at verse 28. He was sitting down in his chariot. He was reading the prophet Isaiah. Now, reading scripture doesn't make a person a Christian. Reading the scriptures, some people just study scripture, read scriptures, and they will boast. They will tell you. You visited them, they will tell you. But they are not saved. They can even go for examination. They even score distinction. But let me tell you, they are not saved. Just like this man went to Jerusalem, went such a great distance from Ethiopia to Jerusalem, then also reading the scripture, he wasn't saved. No wonder God sent this man called Philip to find this man called Eunuch so that he can share the gospel with this man. So what kind of a man was he? The Ethiopian eunuch? Number one, he was a religious man. Number two, he was a restrained man. Look at verse 27. He says he was a eunuch of great authority. Look at the word. Under the queen of the Ethiopians. And in charge of all the treasury, and I come to Jerusalem to worship. So this man, the Bible says that he was a man of great authority. But look at the word, under. Under. Even though he was a man of great authority, he was under someone. Who was he under? He was actually under the queen of Ethiopia. That means he was serving a lady boss. A lady boss. You know those days, ladies, if they are queen, they are called what? Iron lady. Iron woman. It is not easy to serve under a woman. I mean, especially you are a man. With great strength, physical strength, with muscles, with great authority. But you look at this man, he was a man of restraint. He was willing and able to submit himself to the queen of Ethiopia. Let me ask you the question. Are you a man? A restrained man? Can you submit to others? Or do you look down on others? Yes, God may bless you. God may put you in a position of leadership. But do you look down on others? What about others who are put on top of you and they are less educated, less intelligent? They drive a smaller car than you. They have houses even smaller than yours. What if their income is less than you? What if they are not as smart as you? Not as educated as you? Will you submit to such men? Look at this eunuch. What a lesson for all of us. He no doubt was a religious man. He was also a restrained man. A man of great authority. And yet, he was able to under somebody and serve under a lady. Number three, you learn about this man. Not only he was a religious man, a restrained man, the Bible says he was a respected man. Now look carefully. Verse 27. He was put in charge of, the Bible says, all her treasury. So this man must have been a very trusted person. He must be a very honest person. A man of honesty, a man of great integrity. If not, the queen of Ethiopia will not entrust all her treasure, all her saving, all her asset to this man. So this man, you can see that he was a very, very respected man. He probably was a secretary to all her treasure. And I have no doubt this man was very, very well paid. Yes. And he was a man also having one great privileges. Look here, he traveled so far from Ethiopia to Jerusalem in a private chariot. Nobody was inside with him. He was traveling alone in those days. Hardly anybody travel on chariot. It's like a private plane. And this man probably, when he's sitting inside the chariot, maybe the chariot was pulled by maybe 2 to 6 horses in front of him. And maybe right behind him was a train of what? Of all the attendants following him right at the back. And probably inside the chariot, he might have a canopy over his head. And also, if you look at verse 38, he even had a private chauffeur, a private driver that drove him around. What a man of great privilege. What a man. What a man. So not only we learn concerning this eunuch was a religious man, a restrained man, a respected man, he was also a responsible man. Now if this man is irresponsible, the queen definitely will not put him in charge of what? Of all her treasure. So in other words, this man was a very, very faithful man. Look at the life of Jesus. Look at the life of Moses. They were all faithful. When Jesus was in the flesh, he was faithful. Look at this verse. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1 and verse 2. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider who? The apostle. He's the apostle, that's talking about Jesus, the apostle of all apostles. He was a sent one of God. Consider the apostle, the high priest of our confession, who is that? Christ Jesus. Consider him. The Hebrew writer say, look at verse 2. Who was faithful to him who appointed him? Can you see the faithfulness of our Lord Jesus Christ when he spent 33 years on this earth? Not only that, look at verse 2. As Moses, also faithful in all his house. Let me tell you. Ask yourself this question. Are you faithful to God? Rain or shine. Difficulties, problems. All sorts of things may come your way. Are you still faithful to God? Look at the life of Jesus. He encountered so much difficulties and problems. Look at the life of Moses. People grumbling against him, fighting against him, rebel against him. And yet look at this man Moses. He was still faithful to what God says. May we, all of us, be like that. So I've touched on Philip, the mission. Philip, the man. Now number 3. Let's look at Philip, the meeting. Philip, the meeting. Look at the meeting. Number 1, look at his readiness. Readiness to meet someone. Look at verse 29 and verse 30. Verse 29 say, this time, not the angel of God. It was the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God said to Philip, go near. Go near to the chariot. Go near and overtake the chariot. Can you see that? This man was using bus 11. He was walking probably about 92 kilometers. Then when he went there, what did the Spirit of God say to him? He said, go near to the chariot. You know how fast is the chariot. Am I right? He says, you overtake the chariot. And look at verse 30. So Philip ran to the man. He ran. Why did he run? You know how fast the chariot goes. To catch up with the chariot, to overtake the chariot, he has to run. Let me tell you, not all of us are runners. When God chooses somebody, he knows whether you can run or not. He knows. I can't run. I'm not a runner. I'm not a good runner. I'm not able to run. So when God chose this man, Philip, he knew exactly that this man can what? Do what he's going to request him, requested him to do. All of us, let me tell you, we have our own different giftings. Different style of doing things, different personality, different strength and weaknesses. God knows how to use each one of us. God knows how to deploy any one of us to any of his tasks. God knows. But I want you to see one thing, is his readiness. Yes, you may not run like Philip, but you can be as fast, and as fast as what Philip did. You can follow his example. Number two, his route. His route. Talking about the meeting, look at the route. The Bible says that it was a desert area. You know, in the desert, there's no roads, right? And there's one, no road sign. Thank God for a country, for the city of Penang. Even Butterworth, wherever you go, there are road signs. But in the desert, there's no road, there's no road signs. How is Peter going to know? How is Peter going to meet this man? And this is what I call the providential hand of God in display. God orchestra everything. God arrange everything. So that the two of them will meet each other at the same point. Many people will say that was a coincidence. Let me tell you, it wasn't a coincidence. It was God's arrangement. God knows how to arrange circumstances for us so that we can meet certain people, especially sinners, so that we can bring that sinner to the faith. Look at Psalms 37, verse 23. He says, the steps of a good man are what? Ordered, means established by the Lord. Every step, let me tell you, I don't have time to share with you testimony. And it's true. God guide your steps. God guide your steps. So, here you see the meeting, his readiness, his route. Number three, this man was reading. Look at verse 30. He was reading the book of Isaiah. When you say read, means can be heard. So this man was reading Isaiah 53. Out of so many books in the Bible, 66 books, out of so many chapters in the Bible, he was reading Isaiah chapter 53. You believe it or not? This is not coincidence. God was guiding this man so that at that point of time when he met Philip, he was reading that portion of scripture. And that scripture, Isaiah 53, talks about our suffering Savior, how he laid down his life for all of us through his what? Bruises. Through his what? Stripes that he received so that we can receive our salvation and healing. So not only his readiness, his route, his reading. Number four, his request. Look at verse 30. Philip asked this man. Philip saw what he was reading. And Philip straightaway asked this man. What was the question he asked? Verse 30 said, do you understand what you're reading? Now look at the next one. The response of this man. Look at verse 31. This man say, how can I? I want you to underline that three words in your Bible. How can I? Now this man was a man of great authority. This man was a what? Was a man of great intellect. He knows a lot of things. But when it comes to the scripture, he was what? He was just like a baby. He don't understand what he was reading, even though he was very good in his language. Verse 31 say, how can I? Look at the word. Unless someone guides me. Now, if you're a young convert, if you're a young Christian, if you're young in the faith, if after many years you're still young in the faith, let me tell you, you need someone to guide you. Get yourself into the life group. Get yourself into some so-called, maybe Bible study. Our church have this adult Bible class. Please, go into the YouTube. Don't know, you ask any one of our church members. They will guide you. Study the Bible. I just finished all the 66 books of the Bible. From Genesis right down to Revelation. If you don't understand the Bible, please let the Holy Spirit, let God guide you. Go into that channel right in our church, Tabernacle of Grace. And then open it up. And then so that you can learn whatever you can learn from God. So this man cried out to God, unless someone guides me. Can you see this man? He was willing to learn. He was willing to learn. I thank God for my son-in-law, Pastor Kevin. Pastor Kevin Tay, our senior pastor in the church. There are a lot of things I don't know. When come to handphone, when come to internet, when come to computer, I tell you, this man guide me. I'm older than him. But I'm still willing to learn. Now remember, all of us, as long as we are on earth, don't ever say that I no need to learn. All of us need to learn. We need someone to guide us. We need someone to teach us. Can I hear a big amen right in your own home? Amen. Now look at verse 31. Verse 31. He asked Philip to come up. Philip was down there beside the chariot. He was still running. This man said, come out, come out. And he invited Philip to sit with him. That was his response. That was his response. Let me share quickly with you. If you have a desire to win souls for God, one-on-one basis, let me give you three pointers. Three things you must be. Three things. Very quickly. Number one, you must be an ordinary Christian. The picture inside the slide is a pastor. You be an ordinary Christian. You no need to be a pastor to be a soul winner. Can I hear me? Amen? You no need to be an ordained pastor in order to win souls. You can be just a layman. You can win soul. Be an ordinary Christian. God always use ordinary people. Just like Philip, a man who served table. God use him. God can use you. Yes. Amen. Do you know in the book of Acts, many times we are mistaken. I want to show you something. If you look at Acts chapter 8 verse 1. Everyone, the Bible says, all were scattered except what? The apostles. Do you know in the early church, the work of evangelism, they were all done, listen carefully, they were all done by ordinary people. They were all done by laymen. Is that a shocking to all of you when you read this? All went out. Look at chapter 8 verse 4. Everyone preaching. In those days, it was the layman that was preaching. And verse 1 says, the apostle didn't go out. Why the apostle no need to go out? After training, you got to go. And God knows very well. God put a scripture right there to teach all of us. God knew very well the apostle was sure preach the gospel. They were sure preach to multitude. They will also preach to one-on-one basis. There's no doubt about it. You can read the scripture in the book of Acts. But then the scripture, the Bible, purposely pointed out to us that it was the layman's job, that did all the witnessing in the early church. No wonder after 6 months, according to this G. Morgan Campbell, he says within 6 months, the church has grown to 250,000 in membership. You know, today's church, they always expect pastor to be everything and to do everything. The church needs to grow up. Can I hear you? Amen. It is time for you to witness to souls. Don't always think that the pastor is the pastor's job. Cast out demon, pastor. Healing the sick, pastor. Winning soul, pastor. Calling people, pastor. Everything is pastor. What about you? Look at the Bible. Acts 8 verse 1 and Acts 8 verse 4. Laymen were the one that were used by God to do the work of evangelism. Don't forget this. Don't always say it's the pastor's duty to do this and to do that. The church need to have a paradigm shift. If you want to advance in grace, there needs to be a shift. Cannot all the time, pastor must do everything. Calling also have to be pastor. Visitation have to be pastor. Visit the sick also have to be pastor. Of course, the pastor have to do that. Maybe. But what about you? Can't you call someone? Can't you visit someone? I'm sure you can. So number one, if you want to be a soul winner, be an ordinary Christian. Don't wait until you become full-time. Don't wait until you become a pastor. Then you win souls. No, you can be an ordinary Christian and still used by God. Number two, be an obedient Christian. Look at verse 27. Angel of God told him, arise and go. And he went. And verse 29, Spirit of God said to him, go near, overtake the chariot. And what did he do? He went. And he ran, actually. He ran. Can you see? Such an obedient man Philip was. Remember, God can never use a stubborn Christian, a disobedient Christian. You and I, if you're a layman, you must be his witnesses. You must be his soul winner. You must be his fisher of men. You must not close your mouth. You must open your mouth and share Christ to people if the Spirit of God leads you. Look at chapter 8 of Acts, verse 35. Learn from Philip. Bible say, verse 35, then Philip opened the mouth. Then Philip opened the mouth and preached Jesus to him. You know what is today's problem in the church? Not only our church, but other churches. Members don't want to open their mouth to talk about Jesus. That's the problem. They were reluctant to preach. They were reluctant to witness for the Lord Jesus. That is the problem in most of the churches today. That's why churches are dying. Churches are on the decline. So wake up, church. We are living in the year 2022. If you want God to use you, be an ordinary Christian. Be an obedient Christian. Number three, be an observant Christian. Look at verse 30. Philip ran to him and heard him reading. You see, Philip was a very observant man. He heard this man was reading. This man never cried out. He says, please help me. Please teach me. He never said that. He was reading out loud. And then, Philip notices that there was an open door. God opened it for him. And straight away, he took the opportunity and preached Christ to the person. We need to be very, very alert. We need to be observant. We need to understand when God is doing something, how we can tap in, jump in, and then do His work. So I've touched on Philip the mission, Philip the man, Philip the meeting. Lastly, very quickly, fourth point, Philip and the ministry. Look at the first one, his confession, the eunuch's confession. Look at verse 35. Don't miss this, verse 35. Then Philip opened his mouth. And beginning where? Beginning at that scripture, preached Jesus to him. Look at the next verse, verse 36. Now notice carefully. Verse 35. Philip preached to him concerning Jesus. Look at verse 36. Now as they went down the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, "See, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized?" Let me ask you the question. When you come to verse 36, do you think that this man at that point of time was a safe person because he was asking for baptism of water? Maybe some of you will say, yes, after listening the gospel, Philip preached Jesus to him. Now he wanted to be baptized in water. So he looked at water, he said, there is water. Was he safe? The question is, was this man safe? What is the answer? If you say that he was safe, then you are wrong. Let me tell you, this man was not even safe. Yes, he heard about Jesus, but he wasn't safe. Let me prove it to you. Look at verse 36. What this man say? What hinders me from being baptized? What hinders me? So he knew that. He wanted to be baptized in water, but he knew that something was standing in the way. So what did Philip do? What did Philip do? What did Philip say? Look at verse 37. Philip say a very profound statement. Listen, listen, listen carefully at verse 27. Philip say what? If you believe with all your heart, you may. You see, water baptism is for who? It's for those who believe God with all their hearts. You must believe God with all your hearts. Then you take the water baptism. So Philip say, you can, provided. If what? If you believe with all your heart. Now look at his confession of faith. What he says at verse 37. He answered and said, I believe. Look at the two words. If you believe, then you can get baptized in water. Then he says what? I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Then that to me is the breakthrough. That to me is the salvation. Yes, he wasn't saved before he came to that point where the water was there. But he got saved after he said, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Now what did the Bible say in Romans 10, verse 9 and verse 10? The word of God say, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart. Look at the mouth and the heart. Very important. Very important. Your mouth, confession, and your heart, belief. If you believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Safe. Verse 10. For it is with your heart that you believe. Look at the word heart. Believe. And are justified. It is with your mouth, that you profess your faith and are saved. You see, heart, your mouth, that result in what? Salvation. So look at verse 37. When he confessed with his mouth that Jesus is the Son of God, and when he said that he believed, that's where he got saved. That's why personally, I don't believe in infant baptism. Our church don't practice infant baptism. Neither do we baptize children that's underage. Yes, they need to come to the understanding. Yes, sometimes the spouse will tell their husband or their wife, you need to get baptized in water. You don't need to tell them. Yes, they themselves must confess. They themselves must say that they want. If because the husband says so, you get baptized in water. If your wife says so, then you get baptized in water. That is not water baptism. You must have the initiative. You must want it. You see, children, they all depend on the parents. Parents say baptize, so they baptize. That's not good. You see, when I got baptized in water, it was out of my own initiative. Yes, when I baptized my children, they were in their teens at that time. Not children. I want to encourage you. Let them know who they believe first before you encourage them for water baptism. Then verse 38. He commanded, that means the eunuch, commanded the chariot to stand still. And both Philip and eunuch went into the water. Who baptized who? Philip, of course. Philip baptized this man. Lastly, the cheer. The cheer. Verse 39. This man went on his way rejoicing. You see, that's what salvation can bring to our soul. Joy unspeakable will flood our soul if we give our heart to the Lord Jesus. Let me close very quickly concerning the life of Philip. Number one, for the first time in his life, after he witnessed to this man, he got a free transportation. He was transported. Look at verse 39. He says, the Spirit of God caught Philip away. Now, this is the one and only incident mentioned in the Bible. You call it transportation. From ground level to airborne until you reach another destination. The Bible says he was transported from Gaza right up to, look at verse 40, Azotus. I checked the distance. It was about 38 kilometers away. It is something like from Batu Kawan to Crystal Point Church. That's our church. So he was transported. Look at his experience. What an experience the Spirit of God gave to Philip. Now he no need to walk. Now he no need to run. The Holy Spirit gave him a free trip. Bringing up to the air, travel in the clouds, then brought him right to Azotus. Now, I will believe this is literal. Okay, this is literal. This is God's compensation to his servant because of his obedience. Because of his obedience. That's all I have to share. Shall we pray? Shall we pray? Close our eyes. Let's pray. Father, this morning we thank you for the portions of scripture that we have read. Lord, personally, it has challenged my heart. I hope that it has challenged your people as well. That all of us will rise up to become personal evangelists. That we will get involved in personal evangelism. One-on-one. Winning souls for you. We thank you for what Alpha 3.0 is doing. We give you all the praise. But at the same time, help us not to forget to win one on one basis in regards to souls. Help us to be fisher of men. Train us, equip us to become soul winners for your kingdom from today until you return. We give thanks. We pray in Jesus' wonderful and glorious name. All God's people say amen and amen. God bless you.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my master say, I sought His will to know, and in that will I now abide. Wherever He leads, I'll go. Where